Hi folks, this is David Kwan here. I know I'm really late to this topic, but still, I just want to talk about it. I hope you guys are aware that there is still a protest going on right now in Ferguson, Missouri. It's a very small protest, but it's still going on. And that's considering that it's been over a month now since the police officer named Darren Wilson, he shot to death a black American teenager named Michael Brown. And the body of that teenager was left on the streets for about 4 hours, and that's kind of what created this media frenzy, and this story kind of broke out. This particular story started up a lot of debates, fundraisers, ironically, and protests. When the event first broke out, I was kind of like, whoa, this is big. I kind of felt like it was gonna blow up to be something really big, like a nationwide riot, maybe nationwide rebellion would spread. It felt like this could be the LA riots of the 21st century. Well, that hasn't happened. Don't know whether to be glad or disappointed that didn't happen, but, you know, it didn't. On the one hand, riots and rebellions are terrifying. They usually mean people getting hurt, people getting killed, property getting destroyed, and the government law enforcement usually cracks down in reaction. And, you know, things get ugly from that point. So considering that, it is a relief that the protests in Missouri are small. It's mostly just journalists and people living there in the city. And it's pretty much confined to Missouri. It hasn't really spread to other parts of the country. So that's a relief. Still, there is a part of me that's kind of like all for this revolutionary spirit and social activism. And that part of me is kind of disappointed that the public's attention on this issue has seemed to wane and simmer down rather quickly. I mean, I can understand why. As something as tragic in a setting like this is, it's probably something average Americans would really not like to admit is going on as a daily reality in this country. You know, and daily reality for people especially, you know, black and Hispanic Americans. I think Americans would probably rather focus their attention on things that make them feel better or something that they can kind of galvanize their energy around, like doing the ice bucket challenge for ALS research, which kind of blew up at the same time Ferguson was blowing up. And of course, you know, the whole situation with ISIL is blowing up right now, and people are calling for President Obama to take a stance on ISIL, like definitive stance. I think those issues are more uplifting, more energizing, and just it kind of gathers up the energy of the American people more. And obviously it's much less guilt-inducing. You know, talking about ISIL, there isn't much guilt about it among the people who spoke about it. Because the thing is, what happened to Michael Brown in Ferguson, Missouri, it's not an anomaly. It's not it's not something that happened once and only once, you know? Much of the media coverage afterwards have really demonstrated how often it is that white police officers fire a hail of bullets at an unarmed black teenage boy. If we had been paying any attention to the fact that less than 25% of the nation's police force receive proper training on de-escalation techniques and crisis intervention techniques, then these stories probably wouldn't have shocked us to the core like they have done. But then, you know, the shaky cams went up on YouTube and on Vimeo, and it's terrifying that this kind of stuff can happen. It does shock us, you know, that it continues to happen in many parts of the country, that it has been going on for years and years and years. Michael Brown's death spurred a lot of media focus and interest. And that in turn started a lot of intense conversations. Well, if you can call them conversations in some cases. I think that's the optimistic thing about the aftermath, though, of his death, is that now we are more aware about issues. One particular issue, of course, is the militarization of local police forces around the country. And this means that police precincts are now requesting and getting things like armored vehicles, mine-resistant vehicles, riot gear, and really weapons that are fit for war zones. It doesn't really look all that great when considering the fact that they're going to be used against American citizens. These police precincts are able to obtain these weapons as long as they can prove each year that these weapons are being used, or they're going to be used. So that actually gives them an incentive to use these high-powered military equipment. So this is why a simple drug bust, you know, it's a drug bust of a teenager smoking marijuana, let's just say that. In that scenario, it can be quite possible for the police to respond with the fully decked out SWAT team. This is in addition to the fact that many of the people being hired as police officers were formerly soldiers in the military or Marines in the military. And that's problematic in itself because military trained soldiers and Marines quite differently than how local, you know, local governments train their police officers. The goal of the military in a combat situation is to contain the combat zone and to wipe out the enemy. Those goals don't necessarily fit in with the objectives of the police, which is actually, it's different because it's to protect and serve the communities that they're in. So I think the American public is more aware of this issue now, and that's important. It's important if any of the current disturbing reality about American law enforcement is to be changed for the better. It's important to be aware of this. But militarization of police is just one issue out of many. And because of the focus of Ferguson, it was kind of, you know, these issues came to be highlighted. The militarization issue is a huge issue, sure. But I think for people living in cities like Ferguson, Missouri, the more pressing or the issue that they face every day is poverty. And this is poverty fueled by corrupt, racist local state government, and which is stagnated by unequal access to opportunities. A couple of weeks ago, I watched this New York Times video report on how warrants of poor people in Ferguson are actually financing the local municipalities. There we go. That's the word that I was trying to do. But it's pretty much poverty is financing local governments. See, what can happen is that a person can be arrested for a simple violation, and this violation can be something like, I don't know, having a broken taillight on your car. So after this violation, the person is given a court date to appear, and they're given a fine. You know, they're supposed to pay this money. So imagine now it's the day of the court date. The person might not exactly have that much money for the fine because the person is in poverty. Or maybe because that they have to take public transportation, the person is late to the court. Then the person is given another court date because, you know, to, and another warrant is given, you know, and there's additional fines that are charged stacked on top of the current fines. If the person doesn't appear for a court date because they're afraid of being arrested, and this is a common fear that the poor people have because they're not as knowledgeable about the system or they don't have awareness about how criminal justice is operated, then the person is given issued an arrest warrant. And with that arrest warrant, even more charges are stacked on top of the fine that they're given. So this is why, or this is how, in cities like Ferguson, and many other parts of Missouri and other southern states where poverty is really prevalent, especially among people of color, the disturbing thing is that the amount of arrest warrants that currently exist, it can exceed the population size of that city. And by twofolds, by threefolds, there can be three times as many warrants as the population of that city, which is, I don't know, if you ask me, that's quite insane. Southern Poverty Law Center reported recently that there are 26 different ways you can lose your driving license in St. Louis County. That's quite a number, considering that before, there used to be only 5 ways that you can lose your license. A former St. Louis County municipal judge, he's Frank Betterot. He says, you can now lose your license for things that have nothing to do with driving. We definitely have a problem with over-criminalization. And the people, of course, who are the most susceptible to this over-criminalization is, of course, poor people of color. And that exacerbates the problem. See, without a license, it's really hard to get to places, to drive to places, such as the places of employment where you work. So this makes it so that poor people get even poorer and poorer. And because of that, they come to owe their government more and more, whether that be in fines or in time spent in jail. This is one example out of many in how poor people are suffering and struggling in America. It really is, to me, disheartening stuff. It's tragic that this is the reality of so many Americans. There's so much rhetoric that blames and attacks the poor for their horrible situations. Whole histories are ignored when such judgments are made. These people are our fellow Americans, struggling to make a living, trying to make a calm face in the midst of daily violence and inequality. To me, Jon Stewart on The Daily Show, he really nailed it when he kind of said this. He said it in a comical way, but still it's a very serious thing what he said. He says, race is there. It exists. You know, are you tired of hearing about it? Well, imagine how fucking exhausting it is living it. I think that's a powerful point. And that influential comedy host like Jon Stewart can see it and point our attention towards issues like this. That's kind of what keeps me optimistic. That journalists are still right there on the streets of Ferguson, facing a heavily armed police force which can throw tear gas bombs at any moment. You know, I think that's powerful. Thousands of nonprofit and activist organizations across the country are continuing to mobilize. There are some advocating for legislative change. There's some providing relief to the poor. All of them trying to do something about these issues that have remained invisible to so many Americans for so long. Achieving social justice in America seems harder than ever before. And reading the news can be really, really disheartening as more and more kind of things are highlighted, more and more issues. So maybe I'm deluded to be optimistic. But, you know, I just think it's important to keep trying and keep paying attention. Maybe if enough of us are more aware and if enough of us understand what's going on, then perhaps the solutions might be simpler than we're psyching ourselves to be.